based on the true story of Lily Lindstrom, a 32-year-old prostitute who, on May 4, 1954, was found murdered in her small apartment in the Atlas area of Stockholm, Sweden, near Sankarixplan. She had been dead for a couple of days, her skull had been crushed, and the detectives noticed that someone had been drinking her blood. World known as the Vampire Murder Case or the Atlas Vampire. Numerous so-called vampires have committed heinous crimes and been captured providing details of their crimes and desires. This case remains unsolved and is merely a speck in the long list of supposed vampire killers. Her name was Lily and she lived in Stockholm, Sweden. She stayed in a quaint, old house in the Atlas area and had a great life, going out almost every night and meeting tons of interesting people all the time. Strapped for cash, she began a part-time job as a prostitute. She had been doing it for a few days, and everything was going great, but on May 1st, strange things started happening. She got home late that night, and as she was groping for the light switch in the dark, her hand brushed up against something cold and soft near the middle of the room. She desperately searched across the wall for the light, but when she finally reached it, she saw nothing there. Unnerved, she sat down on the couch for a moment to catch her breath when suddenly an intense, pounding headache began. She'd never had a migraine before, but assumed this was one, and mostly forgot about what she'd felt in the dark. The next day she woke up feeling drained and exhausted. The headache had mostly cleared, but when she glanced in the mirror, there was a large bump forming on the side of her forehead. Thinking she must have merely hit her head while asleep, she tried not to think about it. She went out as she had planned. She got home late again that night and, feeling a bit fearful because of last night, found the light as quickly as possible. Everything was going normally, and she felt silly for still being so anxious. She focused her attention on the television, watching reruns and then falling asleep. Abruptly, the headache from the night before started up again, this time even more potent. It throbbed in her skull and hurt so badly she could almost taste blood in the back of her throat. As the night wore on, the headache didn't let up at all. In fact, it got even more overpowering. She went to go take a painkiller and took a sip of water, but it tasted strange, almost metallic. She spit it out into the sink and looked at it, horrified. Instead of the water she'd taken a sip of, a pool of reed blood was swirling down the drain. She took a step back and probed her mouth for some sort of cut or reasonable explanation for the blood in the sink. Without finding one, she got increasingly more disturbed. Swallowing, the metal taste in her mouth subsided while her headache grew stronger. It pushed against the backs of her eyelids, growing more and more intense until her vision began to blur. In the haze of the kitchen, she saw what looked like a tall, pale man standing in the middle of the room. As he began walking toward her, she heard a woman wail in ecstasy, but quickly the moan turned to screams of terror and pain. Petrified, she stumbled back into the living room and passed out on the ottoman to the sounds of fear and agony. Awaking the next morning, she tried to pass off the previous night's events as a headache-induced nightmare, but barely could. It had felt so real, and the bump on her forehead had grown in size. Wanting to get out of the hotel room and forget, she went to some more tourist spots, but still felt on edge, as if someone was watching her. She got home earlier that night, hoping to avoid another creepy experience. At around 7 o'clock in the evening, she got a call from her friend Minnie, asking to come over. Without waiting for a response, Minnie hung up, saying she'd be right there. Minnie came upstairs and knocked on the door. Lily let her in and they talked like old friends do, and had been chatting for about a half an hour when the phone rang again. Lily answered confidently, hoping it was a customer for her newly thriving business. It was a man's voice. He asked her if her name was Lily. Minnie said it couldn't hurt to invite him up, and Lily was happy to oblige. As he walks in the door, Lily gasped. He looked almost exactly like the hazy figure she'd seen the night before, tall and pasty white, but he was friendly and joined in their conversation. He'd brought some drinks, and soon they were all feeling a little tipsy. He said they should play a fun game of truth or dare and, feeling like giddy teenagers again, they both agreed it was a great idea. Soon they ended up alone in her bedroom. A half an hour later they remembered Minnie sitting in her living room, but as she went out to check, Minnie seemed to have let herself out. She smiled and went back to the bedroom. At 9 o'clock that night, Minnie was sure she'd be done with that man and called her up, asking if she wanted to go to the park with her. She didn't answer her phone, and didn't come to the door. Minnie assumed she wasn't quite finished with her guy, and left them alone. The next day Minnie tried to get a hold of her again, but to no prevail. By the next day, Minnie was worried and called the police. The police broke into Lily's apartment and found her lying dead face down on the ottoman. Her skull was bashed in and small, even puncture wounds covered the soft pale skin on her body. Small slices in her skin were also noted, along with the presence of human saliva around the cuts. The whole apartment was meticulously clean. Lily's clothes were neatly folded on a chair and her bedspread was neatly made.